Hello everyone. So this is Dinesh Ponnuswamy from Sai Incubation Center. So in this session, we are going to deal with the topic on how to build a drone. Okay. So I think it will be very interesting to you all. So let's get to the session. So like my previous session on PCB, here also I'm planning to cover certain topics here, starting from what are UAVs and which type of UAV to prefer. So here UAV is nothing but the unmanned aerial vehicle. Okay, that is a common term that is used for all the, you know, all kind of drones or all kind of copters you can see in the market. Okay, so how to choose these UAVs and what are all the components? Okay, how to choose these components and what is the actual flying mechanism over here? So everything we are going to see in this particular video. I think it will be very useful for you. Please listen to this carefully. So let's start with what are UAVs. So unmanned aerial vehicle, in simple terms, it is an aircraft without a human pilot. Okay, so you don't need any pilot on the board, so you can able to control it either manually, or it can be a semi-automatic kind of drone, or it can be fully autonomous. So you can fix the target, so where I want to go. Okay, so I can fix the GPS and a GPS coordinate of the target, and immediately your quadcopter will go to that particular area and it can able to come back. So it can be semi-automatic as well as fully autonomous. And one more important thing which we have to see here is these quadcopters will carry some sensors on it. So it can be a vision sensor. So vision sensor is nothing but your cameras, or even some other sensors like obstacle avoidance, or to sense the environment temperature or something like that. You will be having some sensors on it. Why I stress this point is, so each and every component which you are importing on a quadcopter is very, very important when you are calculating the thrust of a motor. Okay, so I will explain you in detail in the upcoming slides. So this is how your UAV, what is UAV. And the next thing is, what are the types of UAV? Okay, so I have mentioned some four types here, the basic divisions here, starting from the multi-rotor drones. So from the name itself, you can say, so there are multiple rotors is going to be on the drone. So multiple rotors are nothing but multiple motors, the rotating part. Okay, so it can be two motors, or it can be four motors, or it can be eight motors. So based on the number of motors, so the name of the drone can be different. So say for example, if it is having four motors, we call it as quadcopter. So if it is having eight motors, or seven kind of motors, we call it as hex, or we can call it as octocopter, something like that. Okay, so these are different types of multi rotors available. So it is purely based on number of rotating objects. Okay, and we have one more type which is called the fixed wing drone. So here, as the name suggests, you will be having two fixed wings here, but it needs a external force, okay, to take off. Okay, you don't have any multiple rotors here, so immediately you need to have some external force to take off this plane. So once it reaches an altitude, okay, after which it can use some simple rotors at the back or at the front to control its movement. Okay, but initial takeoff, it needs some external force. Okay, so the second thing is fixed wing drone, and the third thing is single rotor helicopter. Okay, it is very much similar to a conventional helicopter. Okay, but here only one single rotor will be available at the top. Okay, so using this rotor, you can able to take off your drone from the land. Okay, only one rotor, but this rotor will carry a propeller of a lengthier one. Okay, whereas when you compare with the multi-rotor kind of drones, the particular propeller will be of a medium size or a lesser size. But whereas if you consider this single rotor helicopter and all, the wing or the propeller will be of a lengthier one. Okay, so that is one difference we need to see. And the fourth type is fixed wing hybrid VTOL. Okay, here VTOL is nothing but vertical takeoff and landing. So it is something like, from the name itself you can say, so the drone can be took off, okay, from the land vertically only, and it can be landed vertically only. You can't able to slide it. You can able to vertically take off and vertically land. So that is a kind of drone we call it as VTOL. Okay, so since this is a hybrid VTOL, so you can able to see both the wing like structure as well as the rotor like structure. Okay, both the motor, so both the rotors as well as the fixed wing kind of structure will be available in hybrid VTOL. So these are the basic drone types you can see in the market. Okay, so today in this session we are going to focus only on the multi-rotor drones. Okay, so all the flying mechanisms and all the choosing of components will be related to multi-rotor drones only, and in the upcoming videos we can look into the other type of drones. Okay, and where can be used. So application is massive. You have lot of application which I have listed some here. So starting from defense, aerial photography, shipping and delivery, geographic mapping, you have lot of applications here. Especially you could have seen in this COVID-19 situation itself. Whenever you turn on a TV to watch a news, so immediately you can see some photographies or videographies from the drone. Okay, so especially for disaster management kind of thing, nowadays this drone is having a lot of applications there. Okay, so if you are focusing on any project or kind of thing, please focus on disaster management, because it has lots and lots of scope. Okay, so that is one thing. And especially in agriculture also, you have precision agriculture. The term precision means using sensors we can able to sense the environment, and we can able to survey that particular land, whether it is cultivable or not, or something like that. So especially in mountainous areas and all, the people cannot go there and they can't able to identify whether this particular land is cultivable or not, or something like that. So you can't able to make decision in those kind of terrains. So especially in those areas, you can send a drone and you can able to do all the kind of surveillance there. Okay, and not only like vision sensor can be of thermal sensor also. Okay, it can be thermal sensors or it can be lidars. Okay, so if you want to make any geographical mappings, okay, any 3D mapping kind of thing and all is supported nowadays. So I think the application wise it has very very vast kind of application is there. So please focus on any one of these. And even for wildlife monitoring, to in order to take a survey on how many species, okay, in a particular wildlife sanctuaries and all, if we want to identify how many tigers are there or how many giraffes are there or something like that, if you want to monitor also, you can send a drone and you can able to monitor in real time. Okay, so that is also one of the beautiful application you can see nowadays. So I have listed some, you can Google for more. And today, as I told you before, we are going to focus on multi-rotor drones. So here I have shown some of the examples of this. So as I told you before, if you have four rotors, so we call it as quadcopter, okay? But in quadcopter itself, you can able to see two types here. One is quadrotor 1 and the quadrotor X. So that means it can be configured. The control of these quadcopter can be controlled in terms of two manners, okay? Either in the X way or in the plus way. Okay, you can control or configure the quadcopter in these two ways. Similarly, you can do this for hexarotor also. So hexarotor also has two kind of configurations, and hexarotor with here you are having a tricopter here, so you will be having three different motors here, right? So hence it is called as tricopter. So you have tricopter is also coming under this multi-rotor drones, and you have octarotor. So octarotor means you will be having totally eight different rotors on the particular drone, and the octarotor also can be configured in two manners. Okay, so today we will be focusing on this quadcopter where four rotors will be there. So before getting into this quadcopter, we need to know about how it works, how to fly this. Okay, so that is very important thing first we need to know. So I'm going to tell you that, please make a note of it. So quadcopter can be controlled, okay, in four manners. Okay, so there are four kinds of control you can give it to a quadcopter. So the first thing is the throttle. Okay, hereafter I'm going to use some technical terms. So throttle in the sense, it is nothing but you want to lift your drone vertically above the ground. Okay, so in order to do that, you have to give the throttle input. Okay, so basically if you want to lift a drone from the ground, so please imagine all the rotors, okay, all the rotors which is on this particular quadcopter has to be on the same speed. Okay, because all the rotors has to be rotating in the same speed in order to vertically take off this particular quadcopter. You have to slowly increase the speed of each and every rotor here. Okay, so once that is done, in the x-axis your quadcopter will come up. Okay, this is what throttle. Okay, and one more important thing is, if I want to move my quadcopter, okay, my quadcopter is now at a stable altitude now. Now what I want to do is, I want to move this particular quadcopter to the front or the reverse. Okay, to the front side or to the reverse side, I want to move. Okay, during that time, what I can do is, there I have one axis called pitch. Okay, I have one axis called pitch. So using this, what I can do is, I can control this pitch axis. Okay, so if I control this pitch axis in the left or the right manner, what will happen is, my quadcopter will move to the front or to the back. Okay, so I can either increase this pitch axis, the pitch control, or the I can decrease the pitch control. Okay, based on which, so your motor will, your your quadcopter will move forward or backward. Okay, here your motor 2 and motor 4 are the motors which is responsible for the quadcopter to move forward or backward. Okay, so if you want to move this quadcopter to the forward direction, what should happen? Okay, so this motor 2 has to reduce its speed and this motor 4 has to increase its speed. Okay, just imagine what I'm saying. So if I want to move this quadcopter to the forward direction, I need to move this particular motor 2 in a slower manner and I need to increase the speed of this motor 4 in a upward manner. Okay, so if I do that, automatically your quadcopter will come to the front side. Okay, so similarly, if I want to move this quadcopter to the left or right, okay, if I want to move to the left or right, then I will go for roll axis. Okay, roll axis is over here. Okay, so if I move this particular axis as a reference, now what will happen is, either I can increase or decrease the speed of the motor 1 or motor 2. So if I want to move my quadcopter to the left, okay, say for example, so I want to make this motor 1 to a higher speed and I want to make this motor 3 as the lower speed, so that the drone will come to the left side. Okay, similarly, if I want to move to the right side, what I have to do? So I will reduce the speed of the motor 1 and I will increase the speed of the motor 3. So I can make my quadcopter to move to the right. So this is how you will give the control to your quadcopter. Apart from this throttle, roll and pitch, you have one more axis, one more control. We call it as yaw. Okay, yaw is nothing but the Z axis control. So where you can rotate this particular drone from a fixed position. Okay, you can change its direction, whether to face the north or east or west or south. You can rotate your particular quadcopter with reference to the Z axis. Okay, this axis we call it as yaw. Okay, so when you rotate your drone in X axis, we call it as roll, and if you rotate it in the Y axis, we call it as pitch. And if you rotate in Z axis, we call it as yaw. So this is the major, terminologies we need to consider before, seeing the working of a drone. Okay. So the next thing we need to know here is, so please remember, whenever you are giving throttle, okay, so immediately your quadcopter will not take off from the ground. Okay. Before that, we need to check certain things. Okay. The first thing is, the motors which is connected on the quadcopter is connected with some propellers, right? So these propellers are not all same. Okay, these propellers will be different in nature based on their design itself. Okay, each and every propeller will be different. Okay, say for example, here two propellers are clockwise propellers and two other propellers are anti-clockwise propellers. Okay, so from the design of that wing, we can say whether it is a propeller with clockwise direction or a propeller with an anti-clockwise direction. I'll tell you how to choose that in the upcoming slides. So before that, please consider this. So whenever you are placing this propeller on these motors, so it should be alternative in nature. One propeller should be clockwise, the next propeller, the adjacent one, should be anti-clockwise. And the adjacent should be clockwise, and again the adjacent should be anti-clockwise. It should be alternative in nature. Okay, so it should not be everything as clockwise or everything as anti-clockwise. If you do that, the air which is cut by the propeller, so that will be what? That has to be consumed by the other rotor, okay, other propeller. It has to be cut by the other propeller. But if everything is clockwise, the air will not be cutted properly and the takeoff will not be correct. Okay, it will start to rotate. Your whole drone will start to rotate either in the clockwise or in the anti-clockwise. It will not be stable. Okay, in order to provide the stability and the perfect takeoff, your propellers has to be alternative in nature. Adjacent propellers should be of different direction. Okay, please remember this. Okay, and the second thumb rule is, whenever you are lifting your quadcopter from the ground, you should consider one topology, that your total thrust of your quadcopter should be at least double the time of the gravity. Okay, so here there are three kinds of loads you can put it on this particular quadcopter. Okay, one is the actual weight of the quadcopter. So you are having a frame and you are having some components on it. The motor has its own weight and the flight controller will be there. It will have its own weight and the battery will be there, most importantly. So it will have its own weight. So all the weights are the load for each and every motor. Okay, so say for example my motor, okay, one single motor can able to give me a thrust of 1 kg. Okay, it can able to push the air for up to 1 kg. Okay, so I have 4 rotors here, so total thrust I can able to give is 4 kgs. Total thrust for this quadcopter can be lifted with the help of 4 kg, but my frame and all the other components has consumed 2 kg from it. Okay, so the remaining 2 kg is the only thing left for my motor to lift. Okay, and one more important thing is, not only the weight of the quadcopter, you have one more load here, the load which we call it as gravity. Okay, the actual gravity of the earth is also a kind of load. We have to put a thrust in the opposite direction of the gravity. Okay, that is also the second load. It has to overcome the gravity and it has to come up. Okay, that is the second load we put it on the quadcopter. And the third load is the air drift, the friction which is produced by the air. Okay, the wind which is around the quadcopter also will have the load which will be acting on the propeller, because the propeller has to cut those air, cut those wind, right? So that will also is a kind of load. So as I told you before, you have 3 loads which is opposing your quadcopter to take off. The one is the weight of the quadcopter, and the second thing is the gravity, and the third thing is the wind. Okay, so wind's drift. Okay, these 3 things has to be considered, okay, before choosing the components of these quadcopter. Okay, so please make a note of this. This is very, very important. If any one of these loads gets failed, your quadcopter cannot take off. Okay, and these are the materials which is required for building a quadcopter. Okay, so here I have mentioned the first material as the flight controller board. So either you can make your own flight controller, or you can, you know, buy it from the market. You have lot of flight controllers available. So flight controllers are nothing but you will be having some sensors. You will be having some supporting sensors and a controller in it. Okay, here the most important sensor which is needed for a quadcopter is an accelerometer and a gyroscope. Okay, in order to know the position of a quadcopter, we need to have a sensor called accelerometer or a gyroscope in this particular flight controller. Okay, here the flight controller which I mentioned here is KK 2.1. okay, likewise you can manually make your flight controller, so you can choose any one microcontroller. It can be from Atmega, or it can be from ARM, or it can be from PIC, or kind of thing. So you have lot of microcontrollers available in the market. Choose a right microcontroller and choose a accelerometer and a gyroscope module. Okay, so you can buy it from the market. Okay, you can buy it and you can directly attach with your controller and you can program it. Okay, these flight controllers which I am showing here will have its own firmware in it. Okay, so already the program is being inbuilt in this particular flight controller, so you don't need to worry about it. Only thing is, you need to configure this firmware correctly, because once you give all the connections, it doesn't mean that your quadcopter is ready to fly. Okay, so there are lot of configurations and lot of, you know, trial and errors you have to do before taking off your quadcopter. Otherwise it will end in an accident and it will consume lot of money for you. Okay, so that is one important thing I want to stress you. And the second component which is necessary is the brushless DC motor, which we short form we call it as BLDC. So for multi rotors and all, we need this BLDC, which for the smooth running of the motor. Okay, you can either use a normal DC motor also, but we have lot of advantages over the control. Okay, here you can control this particular BLDC motor electronically using some programs, using some Python program or a C program. You can able to control this brushless DC motor. I will explain you how to do that. And you need to have one electronic speed controller. This is going to act as an intermediate between your flight controller and the BLDC motor. So the flight controller will give the necessary control signal to this ESC, and this ESC will in turn actuate your BLDC motor. It will control the speed, okay, based on the command input from the flight controller. So this ESC is also very, very important. And one more thing is you have a lot of manufacturers for this ESC. So there are some local manufacturer also, there are some duplicate manufacturers also. Please, while you are purchasing this ESC, you go directly to the shop and check it with a battery. You take a battery with you and just check it, and then you can import it on the quadcopter, because each and every components you are importing on a quadcopter is of costlier rate. So if any one gets failed, immediately it will have adverse effect on other component, because the battery you are going to use here is 12 volt, 4500 mAh. Okay, imagine. So it is 4500 mAh. That means it is capable of giving 4.5 amps of current in a hour. Okay, since this is a lipo battery, it is capable of burning. So whenever there is an accident, or if there is any short circuit happening in your quadcopter, it is capable of burning. So please be cautious before building this quadcopter. So you have to choose the right component. Okay, and you are having one remote control here, so you can buy it from the market. It will cost around 5000 to 7000 rupees. So it has the frequency range of 2.4 gigahertz. Okay, it has a longer range of frequency. You can go up to 700 meters to 800 meters from the, if you are focusing on manual control. And you are having 2.4 gigahertz transmitter and receiver also. Okay, so both transmitter and receiver should be binded before, it should be linked together before you are taking off the quadcopter. Otherwise, what will happen is anybody can hack your frequency. Okay, if anybody knows your frequency, they can able to hack your quadcopter. So before that, there is an option to link, or there is an option to bind your frequency signals together. Okay, so these are the basic materials I want to mention you. And the first thing I want to explain about is the brushless motor. Okay, so before choosing this brushless DC motor, we need to know about the topology there. So when you buy from the market, the rating of this particular BLDC motor will be in KV. Okay, so the picture I was showing you is having the 1400 kV specification. Okay, you can see in the picture itself, this BLDC motor having the rating of 1400 kV. So here kV means it's kilowatt. Okay, but what it infers is, say for example, if I'm giving 1 volt to this particular BLDC motor, it is capable of rotating at the RPM of 1400 RPM. okay, if it is 1400 kV, that means, I'm repeating again, if it is 1400 kV of BLDC motor, if I give 1 volt to this BLDC motor, it will rotate to an RPM of 1400 RPM. okay, that is the meaning of that. If I increase the voltage, automatically the rotation per minute will be increased. Okay, so since you can imagine now, okay, for 1 volt itself it can run up to 1400 RPM. So my battery capacity is around 11 volt to 12 volt. Okay, so you can imagine it can go up to 12,000 RPM or 11,000 RPM in a minute. Okay, so that is why we are choosing BLDC motor. The control will be very smooth. Okay, so you can easily increase or decrease the speed of this particular BLDC motor. Okay, so that is the reason we are focusing on this BLDC motor. And you can't supply directly the control signal to this BLDC motor, because you can find three terminals for this particular BLDC. It's not like normal DC motor. Here you need to give three separate phases. Phase A, phase B, phase C for operating this particular BLDC motor, because the construction is like that. I'll show you how it is constructed. So if you take example of this particular video, so you can see So there are two main parts of this particular BLDC motor. Okay, so this is the internal structure. So the outer part we call it as, you know, rotor. Okay, the internal part we call it as stator. Okay, so in most of the conventional DC motors, the rotor part will be inside and the stator part will be outside, right? But in BLDC, it is constructed in such a manner that your rotating part will be outside and the stationary part will be inside, that the stator will be inside. And one more important thing is the outer part, that is your rotor, will be a permanent magnet. Okay, that will be a permanent magnet, and the stator which is lying inside is an electromagnet. So you can find a difference between a permanent magnet and an electromagnet, right? So if it is an electromagnet, so whenever you are giving electrical signal to that particular, you know, stator through a winding, only then it will act as a magnet. In rest all the times it will just act as a conductor. Okay, can you get my point? So that is why this stator which is lying inside the BLDC is electromagnet. So it is being magnetized or demagnetized based on the electrical signal you are applying to the windings of each and every poles. Okay, so when you apply, you know, some signal, some pulses to this pole, so say for example here you, it is mentioned as S, and here it is mentioned as N. Okay, so S means south and N means north. Okay, only if this particular pole is magnetized, you will get these two poles, north and south here. Okay, so these two poles are getting magnetized because of the winding which is rolled on this particular pole. Okay, this winding will get an electrical signal. Immediately this pole will change into a magnet and it will provide the corresponding pole, whether it is a south pole or a north pole. Okay, now what we can do is, since I told you we have three phases, phase A, phase B and phase C, so you can supply this phases in a particular time sequence. Okay, if phase A is provided, one of the pole will be magnetized. Okay, if phase B is provided, the second pole will be magnetized. Okay, so accordingly, so based on these pole changes, see here, so in this particular area, so you can able to see, this is your A phase and this is your B phase and this is your C phase. Okay, if I supply electrical signal to the A phase, so that particular poles will be magnetized. Okay, and this pole will be magnetized and you will get the corresponding pole numbering there. Say for example, if my B phase is magnetized, now it will get a pole as north pole and the south pole. Okay, it will get magnetized and it will provide the poles here, north pole and the south pole. Okay, the permanent magnet which is rotating above, so it will have a permanent pole with them. Okay, the polarity of the permanent magnet is fixed, so one side it will be south and other side it will be north, it cannot be changed. Okay, so now what will happen is, if this B phase is magnetized, one side of the pole will obtain north. Okay, at the same time the pole which is nearer to the, you know, the rotating part will be south. Okay, here the rotating part is south and the pole which is magnetized just now is north. So immediately these two poles will attract each other, because opposite poles will always attract each other. So the rotating part will come to the position of the phase B. Okay, immediately now what will I do is, I will energize the phase C. So immediately your rotor will move to the phase C. Then I will energize the phase A. Again your rotor will move to the phase A. Okay, can you get my point? So in a particular time sequence, you will keep on energizing your phase A, phase B and phase C. Okay, that is why you need three terminals for BLDC motor. Okay, so these three terminals cannot be energized directly from a flight controller. That is why we are going for a electronic speed controller. Okay, by the structure itself you can see, so there are three outputs, phase A, phase B and phase C. So these are going to get connected with the three phases of my BLDC motor, and this particular ESC will consume two inputs, one is red and other one is black. That is nothing but it is going to directly connected from your battery. okay, your 11.1 volt or 12 volt battery, these two terminals will be connected. Okay, and apart from this, you are having three more wires. Okay, that is for connecting with the flight controller, because I need to control the speed of this BLDC motor, right? So I need to send some command signal from my flight controller. So that is given by with the help of these, you know, these three wires. Okay, so one is the signal wire, another one is the VCC, and another one is ground. Okay, I'll tell you how to connect this with the flight controller when we are focusing on that. So please remember this alone. So this ESC will be connected with this three terminals of this BLDC motor, and other two terminals will be connected to the battery, and the remaining three terminals will be connected to the flight controller. Okay, and this is the flight controller which I was showing you. It is KK 2.1.5. likewise, you have lot of other vendors also. You have CC3D and the autopilot kind of vendors are also available, and even using Arduino itself you can program your own flight controllers. That is also there. So this is one of the conventional one, and it's of lower cost. I have bought this from the market, and I'm going to explain it with the help of this. So when you see this particular KK 2.1, you'll be having one display here. So if you want to do any configurations, okay, there are some configurations you have to make. So in order to do those configurations, you can visualize this with the help of this particular display. This is an OLED display, and there will be two sections here. One is at the left side and other one is at the right side. So each section, each pinouts will be having three different columns there. Okay, so on the left side you can find 1 2 3 4 5 rows. Okay, 5 rows together, right? So this is where, here is where you will connect your RF receiver. Okay, so the as I shown you before slide, so you are having one 2.4 gigahertz receiver, right? So the control signals from this receiver has to be connected to this part of this quadcopter flight controller. Okay, so the left side of your KK 2.1 will be connected with the RF receiver module. Okay, and your KK 2.1 has the right side pin headers. Here is where all your ESCs will be connected. Your electronic speed controllers, which is in turn connected with the BLDC motors, will be connected to this particular area. Okay, in a quadcopter you will be having four ESCs, obviously, right? Because we are having only four rotors there, so you will be having four ESCs there. So the control inputs of the four ESCs will be connected to this right side pin connectors of this particular KK 2.1 board. Okay, in order to do these configurations, we are having four different user buttons at the bottom. So you can use these buttons to navigate around the settings, and you can able to do some configurations there. So this is just to navigate through the menu. Okay, and you can set some values there. I will discuss it later. And apart from this, you will be having some LED indications, and you will be having some buzzer indications. So buzzer and LED indications are very mandatory in a quadcopter, because for safety measures these buzzer has to be connected. Okay, here you are having provision to connect the buzzer at the top. Okay, so these buzzer has to be connected, because there are two modes of operation in a flight controller. One is the safe mode and other one is the armed mode. Okay, if it is a safe mode, you can use that mode for configuring. Okay, so whatever the configurations or whatever the things you want to do it on the on the quadcopter. Okay, you are going to lay your hands on the quadcopter. Okay, during that time you can switch it to the safe mode. Okay, so if it is in safe mode, the buzzer will be keep on buzzering at a particular frequency. Okay, if it is changed to armed mode, that means you are ready to fly. Okay, now accidentally if you have moved the stick on the transmitter, immediately your rotor will start to move. So this time you can't lay any hands on the quadcopter, it will accidentally damage your hands. Okay, in order to differentiate between the armed mode and the safe mode, these LED indications and buzzer indications are very much mandatory in a quadcopter. Please don't neglect it. If you get a flight controller, so please connect it first with a buzzer. Okay, so these are the things I want to mention you now. So, and it will be having one main IC, main microcontroller, inside this flight controller, and that microcontroller will hold a program. Okay, that will get the input from the accelerometer gyroscope, and accordingly it will give the actuating input to the ESCs, okay, the ESC connections here, which is over here, right? So those connections will be getting the output. Okay, so based on some calculation, based on some algorithm, this particular flight controller should need to make some decision. Okay, I will tell you what are all the decisions your flight controller will make. Okay, so the first decision is, whenever you move the stick or whenever you control your drone from your transmitter, okay, this is the remote control which I was showing you. So whenever you are moving the stick, what will happen is this control signals will be picked up by your receiver. Your 2.4 gigahertz receiver will receive this signal, okay, and from this receiver the signals will go directly to your flight controller. Okay, on one side of the flight controller your receiver signal will be picked up, okay, and once the signal is picked up, that will be given directly to the main microcontroller of my flight controller. In that microcontroller, I could have written some program to read that input, okay, that analog input from that particular receiver, and I'm going to make some decision whether to make my quadcopter to move up or to move left or right, or to adjust in the front or the back. Okay, as I told you before, you have four different control signals, right? So pitch, yaw, and roll, and you have this throttle. So these control signals has to be correctly given based on the receiver input, based on the receiver command. Okay, so all these decisions are taken care by the microcontroller's program. Okay, and one more decision your microcontroller has to take is, whenever your quadcopter is on the on the certain altitude, so what happens if any wind blows on it? Okay, if any wind blows on your particular quadcopter, immediately what will happen is your quadcopter will become unstable. Okay, it will move in a direction towards the wind. Okay, so during that time, what I have to do is, I have to make my quadcopter to come to the stable position. Okay, immediately I need to adjust the speed of each and every motor accordingly. So if my quadcopter is moving to the right side, okay, immediately I need to make the speed corrections in my particular motors, and I have to adjust my quadcopter to come to the stable position. Okay, in order to do this and all, we have to calculate some errors. Okay, from the stable position, how much my quadcopter is deviated to the right, or how much it is deviated to the left, or something like that. Okay, so these errors can be calculated with the help of accelerometer and the gyroscope. Okay, and the algorithm, the beautiful algorithm used for calculating these errors is PID controller. Okay, you could have heard in your academics PID, so which is nothing but proportional, integral, and derivative kind of controller. So I'm going to explain you in detail about this, because whenever you are doing your own quadcopter, you are going to design your own quadcopter, and you are not relying on any available flight controllers, then definitely you need to know about this algorithm. Without this algorithm, you can't able to design any quadcopter. Okay, so I'm going to explain you. It is very simple. Okay, so this proportional, integral, and derivative will have its own functionality in the algorithm. Okay, say for example, I have a quadcopter which is in my base. Okay, it is lying in my base with the initial RPM of 100 RPM. Say for example, it is a minimum RPM. So in this 100 RPM and all, this quadcopter cannot fly up. Okay, it will still lay on the ground, but my propeller will be keep on spinning. Okay, now my quadcopter is at the base. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to move my throttle stick on my transmitter, my remote controller. Okay, so what will this throttle do basically? It will take off your quadcopter from the base to the above altitude. Okay, so when my stick is moved to certain distance in my remote controller, immediately the speed of the each and every motor which is lying on the quadcopter will start to increase its speed. Okay, when I go to a certain level in the stick in the remote controller, the speed will be keep on increasing on the motor of the quadcopter. Okay, now slow by slow the RPM of the motors will be increasing, and up to a certain point, when it reaches the necessary thrust, automatically your quadcopter will start to come up. okay, like this. So your quadcopter will start to come up based on the stick movement, okay, stick movement on the remote controller. What happens if my target altitude is 50 meters? Okay, I need to stabilize my quadcopter at a height of 50 meters. Okay, but while I was moving my, you know, stick, okay, when I was moving my stick, so here please remember the distance, how much distance you have moved your stick now. So that will be directly proportional to the speed of the motor. That will be directly proportional to the, in turn, to the altitude. Okay, so how much distance you move the stick, okay, that will be mapped to the speed of the motor, and again it will be mapped to the altitude. Okay, so now what will happen here is, so when you move the stick, okay, so because of the wind thrust, okay, because of this rotor is cutting the wind and it is coming up, the quadcopter is coming up, immediately what will happen is, sometimes it may cross the target altitude, okay, it might cross, okay, so until, so it cannot directly reach the 50 meter accurately, okay, it will directly shoot up, okay, it will just go to 55 meters or, you know, 60 meters above, but your target altitude is just 50 meters, okay, so it will go up, okay, so now what we have to do is, we have to sense the actual position of this quadcopter from the help of accelerometer and the gyroscope. Okay, that is why we need that accelerometer and gyroscope. What is the actual position of my quadcopter? Okay, whether it is at the right altitude or whether it is at the right direction or at the right rotational, you know, acceleration. Okay, something like that. So I am getting the input from that particular sensor and I am comparing with the target altitude. Okay, so what is the altitude which I got is 55 meters, but my target altitude is 50 meters. So what is the error here? So 5 meter is the error. Okay, so immediately what I have to do is, I have to reduce the speed of these motors. Okay, I have to reduce the speed of this motor so that your quadcopter will come down. Okay, it will come down a bit. Okay, now also automatically when this particular speed is slowed down, your quadcopter will fall drastically. It will not come gradually, it will try to fall drastically. Okay, now what will happen, again it might cross your target altitude downwards. Okay, it might cross your target altitude. Your target altitude is now 50 meters, but your quadcopter, because of the slowing down of your motor, it has reached to 45 meters. Again the error is minus 5. Okay, again the error is minus 5. Again what I have to do, I have to increase the speed of the motor again. Again I have to decrease the motor, I have to increase the motor. Likewise, by seeing the error, I need to adjust the speed of each and every motor of the quadcopter. Okay, here is where your proportional controller comes into picture. Okay, this proportional controller will have one constant number in it. Usually the proportional control will have the minimum value at first. Okay, say for example your proportional controller will have the value of 5. Okay, the value of 5 will be there. Okay, at each and every instant, in order to reduce the error, what will happen is, this 5 will be either multiplied or divided by the, or added or subtracted by the, you know, the actual altitude. Okay, so what will happen, it will keep on adjusting the altitude. Okay, and every time it adjusts the altitude, it will come and compare with the target altitude. Okay, the current position will be compared with the target altitude, and if the error is persist, what will happen, again this P controller will have its constant, right? That value will be again multiplied or divided, and based on that again the speed will be adjusted, and again it will come to the, try to match the target altitude. Okay, so here there is one important thing we need to consider is, so what is the current state of the quadcopter? Okay, that is taken into account here. Okay, what is the current state of the quadcopter? That is taken down and that is compared with the target altitude and based on which the decision is taken, right? So here one difficulty is there. You know what is the difficulty? Now if the quadcopter is very much near to the target altitude, now what will happen is, so because of this multiplying factor in this proportional proportional controller, what will happen is, it will become unstable. It will keep on multiplying, it will keep on dividing, the motor speed will be increasing, decreasing, so it will be keep on doing it, okay, in order to achieve the target altitude. So because of this, what will happen is there will be some instability, especially whenever it is nearing this target altitude, right? So during that time, there will be some instability in the quadcopter. Okay, so here comes the help of the integral controller. Okay, so the proportional controller, it is just to achieve the target altitude only up to a certain point. And once the target altitude is achieved, so in order to achieve the better stability there, you need to go for integral controller. What this basically do is, what this integral controller basically do is, once it detects the error, okay, once this detects the error, it compares with the previous error, the past error. Okay, say for example, now the current error is 5, okay, but the previous error was 6. Okay, so now what this integral will do is, it will compare the current error of 5 with the previous error of 6. Okay, and it will check whether this error is more than the previous error or not. Okay, in this case, my current error is 5 and the previous error is 6. So it is not more than the previous error. So immediately what will happen is, it will try to control the speed of the motor. Okay, but if the error is more, okay, the, say for example, if the current error is more than the previous error, okay, more than the past error, the speed control will not happen. Okay, so it will try to reduce the error. Can you able to understand my point here? So since your proportional controller will provide lot of instability in whenever you are going for this target altitude, your error will be keep on increasing, keep on decreasing, keep on increasing, keep on decreasing without any threshold. Okay, so this integral, what it is going to do is, it is going to fix a threshold for this particular error. Okay, if it is, if your current error is more than the past error, okay, if the current error is more than the past error, it will not allow. Okay, it will not allow that particular stage to happen. The current error has to be minimum, it has to be lesser than the past error. So this criteria, this scenario will be taken care by this integral error. So because of that, so if there is any error like this, so I have shown one waveform here. So here this line, the linear line with the stable line, that is the actual level. Okay, but whereas the zigzag line which you are seeing here, the zigzag waveform which you are seeing is nothing but the quadcopter, the altitude of the quadcopter, which is trying to meet that particular stable state. Okay, at initial state what happens is, it has overshooted. Okay, it has gone above the target. Okay, so here you will be having a lot of error here. So in order to reduce this error, we might have used the P controller. Okay, so once this P controller is applied, again there will be some instability in the what, in the particular system. So in order to avoid this instability, so what we will do is, we will introduce this integral controller there in order to reduce the as much error is possible. Okay, it will try to reduce the error. Okay, it will try to maintain this error as low as possible. Okay, so immediately you can reach this stabilized state. Okay, so how fast you are reaching this stabilized state, that is very important. Okay, so in order to reach a faster rate, if you want to make your quadcopter stable at a faster rate, because especially in the previous example I have told you, right, whenever there is a strong wind blow which is blowing on your quadcopter, immediately what will happen, your quadcopter will suddenly go unstable. Okay, again your quadcopter has to come back to the original position very immediately. Otherwise, what will happen? It will start to follow the wind direction. It will fall apart. Okay, so immediately it has to come back, right? So how much error and how much error has to be calculated, and this error has to be rectified and minimized as soon as possible. Okay, that is where your derivative comes into picture. Okay, what this derivative will do is, derivative controller will do is, it will look for the future. Okay, your proportional has looked for the current state, right? Your integral has compared it with the past state, right? But your derivative, what it will do is, it will predict, okay? So based on the proportional data and based on the integral data, what is the current altitude and what is the past altitude, past error and everything. Based on this analysis, what this derivative controller will do is, it will predict in next few seconds where my quadcopter will be. What will be the position of my quadcopter? Okay, whether it will be in the, you know, whether it will be in the unstable state or the stable state, or it will be nearer to the unstable state, exactly how much value it will be. Likewise, so this derivative, using calculation, it can able to say what will be the future term. Okay, if the future term has lot of errors, immediately it will adjust the P and I terms and it can make the error minimization very sooner. Can you get my point? So always remember this thumb rule: your proportional will look for the current state, your integral will always look for the past state, and your derivative controller will always look for the future state. Okay, so the firmware or the program which is lying inside the flight controller will take care of these three terminologies only. So whenever you are doing the program, get the input from the accelerometer and gyroscope and put the PID algorithm there and try to make your quadcopter take off with a stability, with a good amount of stability. So this is one of the most important algorithm you need to know. And one more important thing here is, so for P, I and D, there will be some constant values you will be putting inside. Okay, as I told you, I have given P value as 5, I value as 2, or D value as 3, something like that. That is the magnitude you are giving to that particular PID. Okay, so this magnitude will be varied based on the hands of the person who is controlling this transmitter. Okay, can you get my point? Because I might be having one value for P, I might be having one value for I and D. Okay, the same value will not be suited for the person who is, you know, holding this transmitter for the newly. Okay, so why? Because this particular stick movement, right, the stick movement which you are doing it from your finger, okay, so that stick movement is directly proportional to the speed of the motors which is on the quadcopter, right? So how much, you know, how much distance you are moving, so based on that only your speed of the motor is changing, and based on that only altitude is changing, right? So based on the constant value only, the stability is getting maintained there. Okay, so this value, what you have to do is, initially if you are building a new drone, you have to fix these values to the lower value first, take off, try taking off your flight. Okay, if the stability is not good, okay, if the quadcopter stability is not good, try to reduce the, sorry, try to increase that value to some other value, that PID value, the constant value, and again try to, you know, take off your drone. Again, if the instability is there, again change it. Okay, it is something like a trial and error only we can able to do, because this is very, very you know, important one, because most of the quadcopter is getting failed because of this. When you have the right PID value only, you can able to take off your flight correctly. Okay, so many might be you know, buying these components from the market, and you will be fixing it on the frame of the quadcopter, and if you do the taking off, it will not happen at first. It will not smooth at first. Okay, first you need to adjust this PID to a lower value, and slow by slow you have to increase this value, and once your finger gets the right value, then leave it as it is. Don't change that value. Okay, fix that value for the rest of the drones which you are making. Okay, that is the piece of advice I want to tell you. And one more important thing is, for flying a drone, it will take lot of practice. Okay, please remember that flying a drone is not that easy. It is having a separate pilot licensing to do that. Okay, it is not that easy. So only thing is, you need to have a right knowledge about the flying a drone before you are buying it from the market. Okay, so it will end up in an accident either, or it might, you know, cause some serious damages, or it might cause consume more money. Okay, so please have a prior knowledge and then buy these components from the market and try to do it. Okay, and at last, what I want to stress you is, see here, so this is how your quadcopter layout will be. Okay, here the red color ones are nothing but the ESCs which I was telling you. So the three terminals of this ESCs will be connected to the three terminals of the BLDC motor, and the remaining two terminals of this ESC will be connected to the battery. Okay, so the green board which is available at the center, which is nothing but the power distribution board. Okay, so this is for distributing your battery voltage to each and every ESCs, okay, and the flight controllers and all. Okay, so this particular power distribution board is available in the market separately, or else in some of the quadcopter frames also it is available. In some of the frames of the quadcopter, the PCB is itself is available. The copper traces will be flowing on that particular frame itself. On the quadcopter frame itself, it will be available. So you can directly connect. You can solder your ESC terminals onto the frame itself. There are options for that also. Okay, so this is how it will be. Your LiPo battery will be supplying the power to all the ESCs as well as your flight controller. And one more important thing is your flight controller here will get the power from any one of the ESC, not from the direct LiPo battery. Okay, because your flight controller will need only 5 volt for the operation, but your LiPo battery is having the voltage of 11.1 to 12 volt. Okay, don't give the power supply directly from the battery to your flight controller. Okay, this flight controller should have the supply only 5 volt, so that 5 volt can be taken from any one of the ESCs. Okay, so this is very important point you need to consider. Okay, and what I am going to do now is I am going to show you some configuration settings, okay, which I am having in my quadcopter. Okay, so I am going to show some configuration settings. Please listen to that very carefully. That is basic configuration. I am not going to go deep into it. If you are buying a new flight controller, these are the basic configurations you have to make. So in order to make your quadcopter take off. So this is the KK2.1 board which is I'm having in my in my desk. So when I turn on this particular KK2.1, either it will show two indications here. Either it will be safe or it will show some error. Okay, in my case it is safe. In some people it will be showing error. So the error might be because there are two reasons. Okay, so when you are turning on your KK2.1, your RF receiver and your RF transmitter has to be linked. Okay, please remember this point alone. So while you are turning on your KK2.1, the RF receiver which is connected on the KK2.1 should be linked with the transmitter remote controller. Okay, so you have to turn on your remote controller before turning on your KK2.1. This is first thing. Okay, and the second thing is the accelerometer or the gyroscope which is available in this KK2.1 has to be calibrated properly. Okay, so I will tell you how to calibrate it. Okay, so here you are having 4 buttons at the bottom. So in order to go inside the menu, I will click on the last button. Okay, so it will give you some list of configurations here. I can use this up or down button to move through this configuration. Okay, and here if you see, there is one option called accelerometer calibration. Okay, now I will go into it. So during this calibration step, please remember, so it will itself show you, place the aircraft on a level surface. Okay, this is very important. So whenever you are trying to take off your quadcopter, please keep this quadcopter in a leveled surface and then do this accelerometer calibration. Okay, now my quadcopter is on my desk, so I don't need to worry about the surface, so it will be leveled only. So now what I can do is I can start calibrating this particular quadcopter. So now I will click continue. So now it will take some time. So all the values which is inside this the algorithm will be adjusted automatically and it will start calibrating. Okay, here it has given me the value in x axis, y axis and z axis. Accordingly my algorithm will be configured now. So now in order to check whether my configuration or my calibration is correct or not, what I can do is in the menu you can able to see two things here. One is the gyro bubble and other one is the accelerometer bubble. Okay, this is nothing but like if you go into the if you go into this accelerometer bubble, what will happen is it will show you one bubble at the center of the axis. Okay, when you move your quadcopter, automatically your bubble will change its position. Okay, see to that whether in the when your quadcopter is untouched, this bubble should be exactly at the center of the axis. Okay, this is very important. So once you have done the accelerometer calibration, you have to check whether the bubble is at the center. Okay, this is the second thing we need to confirm. Okay, and the third thing is that here you need to confirm your motor layout, because this KK2.1
can be configured for quadcopter or a tricopter or a hexacopter or a octocopter. Okay, so this motor light has to be fixed. Okay, so here if you press enter, it is showing me the layout of my quadcopter. So it is correct. Okay, I have four motors here, and each motor will have its own direction. Okay, the rotation. Okay, if you check the first motor, it is having the rotation of the clockwise, and if it is the second motor, it is at the anti-clockwise. So as I told you, the adjacent motor should be, the direction should be alternative. Okay, one should be clockwise and other should be anti-clockwise. So here it is perfect. My layout is also good. Now what I can do is, so once I checked the layout, so I can go up, and now what I have to do is I have to go into the PI editor. So there will be an option called PI editor. As I mentioned you before, PID algorithm needs to be set with some PID constants. Okay, so if I enter here, you can able to see for each and every axis, it can be pitch axis or roll or even yaw. Okay, so each and every axis will have its own PI settings. Okay, here this is roll. So aileron is nothing but the, you know, technical term for the roll axis. Okay, so roll, if I want to fix the PI value, I can set it here. Okay, so you have the P limit of 50 and I limit of 30. Okay, so within that I can set any gain here. As I told you in the slide, I have fixed the value of 5, right? So obviously keep your PI value as low as possible if you are taking your flight for the first time. Okay, the stability and the sensitivity will be very less. Okay, so that you can avoid some accidents. Okay, and slow by slow increase that value and try to change it. Okay, similarly you have to do it for, you know, roll if you have set, then you have to do it for pitch, and again you have to do it for yaw. You have to do for all the three axes. You have to fix this PI value for all the three axes. Okay, and once that is set, now what you can do is you can see the indication as safe. Okay, so as I told you, there are two configurations, right? One is the safe mode and other one is the armed mode. So if it is in safed mode, I can't able to operate my quadcopter. But if it is in armed mode, I can able to operate the quadcopter. Okay, how to switch between this safe mode and the armed mode? I'm going to show you. So please remember, so if my KK 2.1 is showing me safe, okay, you can attach the propeller. So till now I have not attached any propeller on my BLDC motor. Okay, please remember, while you are configuring it, it is safe to remove all the propellers. Okay, sometimes accidentally if it is rotated, it will spoil your hand. So please remove the propellers if you are doing the configuration. Okay, so now you can connect the propeller. Now what you can do is I can switch it to the armed mode. Okay, in order to switch to the armed mode, please remember, in your remote controller, so this is the remote controller which I have. Okay, this is 2.4 gigahertz remote controller. Okay, so here what I can do is this is the control for, you know, throttle. Okay, this is the control for throttle. Throttle is nothing but in order to make your quadcopter to take off. Okay, vertically. Okay, in order to adjust the altitude, you will adjust the, you know, the throttle. So throttle input is over here. Okay, this is how you will adjust the throttle. Okay, and if you want to adjust the roll and pitch, okay, here this right side you have the control for roll. So if you do it to the left and right, it is for roll, and if you do it on the top and bottom, it is for, you know, pitch. Okay, this is for pitch control and this is for roll. Okay, now what you can do is, now if I want to switch between the safe mode to the armed mode, this throttle has to be moved to the left for some times. Okay, for some times this throttle has to be holded to the left. Okay, once you have done that, now if you see your KK 2.1, you can see it was showing me safe, right? Now it has changed to armed. Okay, so now if I move the stick in my, you know, in my transmitter, immediately my BLDCs will start to rotate. Okay, now my armed mode has automatically come back to safe mode, because this is programmed in the KK 2.1. Because if you are not operating anything in the armed mode, automatically it will come back for the safety measures. Okay, so Again, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the arm mode and I'm going to try operating this BLDC motors. So in order to go to the armed mode, so I will make it to the left, throttle key to the left. Yes, my KK2.1 is showing armed. So now if I move this throttle, immediately my BLDC motor will start to rotate. Okay, based on how much speed, okay, I can increase or decrease the speed of this throttle. So accordingly the speed of the BLDC motor will increase or decrease. Okay, so this is how you need to take off your quadcopter. Okay, so if you want to disarm it, you can move it to the right. Okay, please remember, if you want to arm it, you will move it to the left, you will hold it to the left. If you want to disarm it, you will move it to the right. Okay, so again it shows safe. So your KK2.1 is now ready to do the configurations. Now it is disarmed.
So I hope you have enjoyed this session. So I'm sorry for the inconvenience that was caused during the live session. So I hope it will not happen in the future. So I would like to show my contact details to you. So I have a company, Sai Incubation Center in Chinniyambalayam, Coimbatore. So if you want to have some hands-on experience, okay, for operating this drone, or if you want to do your own PCB designing and programming and all, you can reach us, okay, through this address. And I have my contact detail over here, so you can make a note of it. And if you like to learn more things about this, about not only drone, about any other technology like embedded system, IoT or artificial intelligence, especially machine learning or something like that, even brain computer interface also, if you are wishing to learn that, I am ready to provide the training to you. I am providing in-house training as well as I am providing workshops also, technical workshops also I am doing. So if you want, you can contact me. And please do subscribe to this channel. So next, my next video will be on brain computer interface. So I will share the link to you once it is published. Okay, thank you for everyone for your patience. Thank you all.